All right. So we've got three chapters and a special chapter left, and then this book is done. And volume 18 will drop right before we start volume 15. But trust me when I say this, for those of you who have not read ahead, who are just sticking with us where we are right now, this part's going to be crazy, and you're really going to want to start the next book ASAP. So I have a feeling you're going to very much enjoy what's coming up next. Chapter 9 isn't the crazy point. Let's see. It's chapter 10. Turning point, part 4. And then chapter 11 is an end and a beginning. So, yeah, dude. It's gonna get crazy when chapter 10 hits. All right. No. Well. Alrighty. Probably could have done all of that off camera. Oh well. It's here and it is what it is. Thank you guys so much. Now, as for updates, I recently made a thing for season 2 of Slime, Abridged. I think it's very funny. And none of you are going to get to see it, sadly. Even our executive producers don't get to see it. Some of the cast, but that's basically it. Not even all the cast can see it. So it's one of those super, super secret things for now that I will show eventually. But yeah, the people that I've shown it to have all been kind of in agreement. Yeah, we should put this in season 2. So, hope you're looking forward to some of the season 2 madness that we're already working on. As for Mushoku Tensei related things, the reactions, I joined Moonlight Sparks for his reactions to Mushoku Tensei from episode 3 onward. So basically, every episode from here to now, I'm going to be on. We're going to record the last two. Yeah, you heard me right. Last two, because we're at the end. The last two on Sunday night / Monday morning. Get those last two done. And then literally he will be done with Mushoku Tensei, who will have been finished watching Mushoku Tensei. He has seen Turning Point 2. So he knows about Orsted now. Sort of. And there's a lot of commentary that's going on. By the time you see the episodes, he'll be finished with the series. And he will also have reacted to the trailer for season 2. If you have not seen it, season 2 trailer is out. Highly suggest you check that out. There's even more trailers that we have to go over and discuss tomorrow on Anime Church. There's also sad stuff that we've got to talk about. Tony is going to join us a little bit for Anime Church to talk about Yu-Gi-Oh! Stuff because I have no ties to Yu-Gi-Oh! Whatsoever. I never watched it, didn't grow up with it, never played the card games, know nothing about it, never read the manga, never really watched The Abridged. Yu-Gi-Oh! Does not impact my life in any way, shape, or form. So I am not the person to talk about how the passing of the creator of Yu-Gi-Oh! Affects them, because it just does not affect my life in any way. He's not the prime minister, he's the former prime minister. Shinzo Abe is the former prime minister. And yes, we will be talking about that tomorrow, but I'm not going to go into it any more than that. So yeah, it's crazy Japanese news coming out. That having been said, though, guys, we are going to move on. I don't have a lot of other updates to really talk about. Let's get started with Mushoku Tensei. Get these three chapters and special chapter out of the way. Let's do it, because we're 74% of the way through. So, chapter 9, The Day of the Floating Fortress. I don't know why I'm so close here. By the way, is the sound okay? I need to check and see if I don't sound crappy. Okay, it sounds good. It sounds good. So, that having been said, let's get started. Chapter 9, A Day in the Floating Fortress. 2 days flew by in the blink of an eye. After regaining consciousness, Zenobia merrily toured the castle, enjoying all the handicrafts within. Being able to mill about freely had him in high spirits. I was relieved that he'd fully recovered from my electric spell. If he hadn't regained consciousness, I wouldn't know what to tell Ginger. Cliff, on the other hand, had changed. Immediately after battle, he'd spoken with Kishirika, and I'd wondered what that was about. It turned out they were discussing his reward for helping her before, a demon eye. He got the eye of identification from her. It allowed him to look at any item and understand its characteristics. He chose it so that he would be able to help if anything like Nanahoshi's illness ever happened again. As always, Cliff was nothing if not heroic. That heroism, however, wasn't helping him to master the eye. He was struggling with it. Apparently, everything he looked at came with a name tag and an explanation. To him, the whole world was flooded with text. He couldn't walk around without Alinalis guiding him by the hand. I was sure he would master it eventually. When he did, people would surely call him Cliff the Wise. Until then, he'd probably have to wear an eye patch. Next was Nanahoshi. We decocted the tea leaves we brought back from the demon continent and had her drink the tonic. Not too long after, Nanahoshi began complaining that she had to use the restroom. Yuruzu helped her to the sick bay and, well, to preserve her honor. I'll spare you the details. Let's just say she was on the mend. How are you feeling otherwise? I asked. Nanahoshi was still bedridden. Her complexion had improved considerably, but the fatigue still remained. She'd also lost a lot of weight. It was as if... Okay, there we go. Everything she had in her stomach had been flushed out, leaving nothing but a skeleton behind. I'm feeling quite a bit better. Ah! So we're immediately going right back to this. Right. Okay. Ah, goodness. And bam. Okay. To be on the safe side, she would need to rest another month, but at least she was in better spirits now. Her expression was different from her usual tense one. Rather, she looked like she was dazed from having just woken up. Her hair was a disheveled mess, sticking out in every direction. I used to think she lived an unhealthy lifestyle, but at least she kept her hair brushed every day. Thank you for helping me. She bowed her head, hands cupped around the warm mug of Soka's green tea, or grass tea. Her formality and sincerity were a rare display. I truly appreciate you shouldering so much risk to go get these tea leaves for me. You, really helped me out. There was something deeply unsettling about hearing her talk like that. Nah, I'm sure she's just feeling weak, so she's kind of out of it. No sweat. You looked after me last time I was in trouble, too. I said some pretty insensitive things to you, and yet you helped me without ever resenting me for it. I don't even know how to begin to thank you. She gave me an apologetic look. I'd never witnessed Nanahoshi acting so politely. Maybe Yuruzu had of Atonement's abilities could transfer personalities on top of stamina. Now that I think about it, I was pretty casual and crude with you, even though you're older than me. I shook my head. I don't mind at all. In this world, I'm only 18. And how old were you before coming here? 30, but don't worry about it. Let's forget the whole age thing and You don't have to be so polite. You can talk to me the way you always have. All right. Her expression was serene as she slowly nursed her drink, as if she could feel the immediate effects. I cleared my throat. I'm sure they already told you, but your sickness won't go away entirely. Yes, I know. Nanahoshi wasn't fully cured of drying syndrome. Socus grass would temporarily break up the mana building inside her, but if left untreated, it could accumulate to the same levels as before. Since she wasn't from this world, she didn't have the immunity to the syndrome that the rest of the people here did. Unfortunately, drinking Socus grass tea would daily would keep it from... Oh, no, sorry. Fortunately, drinking Socus grass tea daily would keep it from building up. There was also the possibility that even a little magic could make her sick. The next illness she came down with might be something even Kishirika didn't know. Something even more ancient than Drine Syndrome. As long as she was here, she couldn't entirely avoid mana. It was everywhere, in the atmosphere and the food we ate. Nanahoshi, you have to return home. You can't die here. Yeah. I'll do anything I can to help you secure a way back home. But I shook my head. I don't need your gratitude or anything. Although, if I get myself into trouble along the way, I hope you'll be there for me in return. Nanahoshi started sniffling as the tears welled up in her eyes. She let out a little muffled sob, her voice barely above a whisper as she said, "Thank you." I patiently waited for her to stop crying. She continued sobbing for a bit, her eyes red and swollen. She spoke in a nasally voice as she said, "But I will go home." "Yeah, I'm sure you want to get back as fast as you can." "No, I mean, I might not be able to repay you for everything before I leave."
Wait, so she wants to repay me for everything before she goes home?
She's more conscientious than I gave her credit for. There's no need to pressure yourself like that. You've helped me out before too, after all. I did that to thank you for helping me with my research. All right, then I would like some detailed advice on a small matter. She frowned. What small matter? For instance, what does a girl around my age want? Sophie and I have a long future ahead of us. We're married and have a child, but I still don't know what's going through her head. Given that you're about the same age, I thought you might know something.
About what Sophie's thinking?
Nanahoshi stroked her chin and stared down at her blanket. She seemed to be seriously considering the matter. Sure, she sure is dedicated to paying me back.
You don't have to answer right now, I said.
You can wait until we have a fight or I want to make up with Sylphie or something.
All right, Nanahoshi said, or nodded, her expression sincere. Although she was close in age to Sylphie, there was much that separated them. They came from different worlds and Sylphie was married. Nanahoshi couldn't understand her completely, even if I had no idea what the guys my age were thinking. Oh no, even I had no idea what the guys my age were thinking.
Wow. Had a little bubble in my throat. That changed my voice. In that case, we'll leave it at that. I'm sure your body is still weak, so take your time recovering.
Yes, I will, Nanahoshi replied. Thank you.
I left the room. If I hung around with just her for too long, I might make Sylphie jealous again. She was cute in that mode, but I took no pleasure in giving her anxiety. I never wanted her to second-guess my love. The fact that I had yet to succeed in doing that was a failure on my part. As I strode down the hallway, evening sunlight poured in through the windows. Ah, the sunset is so beautiful no matter which world you live in. I wasn't so fond of heights, but the view from the floating fortress's spacious garden was tempting. From there, I could look out at the sea of clouds as the sun ducked behind the horizon. Even I liked the little pampering on occasion. With that thought in mind, I made my way outside. The shrubbery was perfectly trimmed, and there were dozens of flowers I had never seen before. As the sun sank beneath the clouds, I bathed the area in radiant light, making it look like a mirage. If I brought Sylphie to a place like this and whispered sweet nothings to her, how would she respond? Knowing her, she would probably turn bright red, drop her gaze to the ground, and squeeze my hand. Surely her reaction would be an adorable one.
All right, once Sophie fully recovers, let's give it a try. I wanted to do the same with Roxy, but alas, demons were forbidden from entering the fortress. Also, it probably wouldn't go over very well, considering Roxy's personality. She'd probably stare blankly at me and say, "You know you don't have to use those corny lines with me, right?" She'd be willing to sleep with me regardless. She was frank that way, even though she didn't look it. But that ain't it. It ain't about sex. I just want to be lovey-dovey. I wanted us to watch the sunset together, Roxy would say. "It sure is beautiful, isn't it?" And I would reply, "Yeah, but not as beautiful as you." And then she would blush and act embarrassed, and that was what I wanted to see. Well, she isn't here anyway, so I'm out of luck. Hmm? As I walked, lost in thought, I spotted a table at the edge of the garden. Three people sat around it. And that was when my master used his magic. This purple light shot out of his right hand, and it charred a Tophis body, paralyzing her in place. Aha! So it was his magic that weakened her that much. Lord Rudius's magic does seem to know no bounds. Zenobia, Ariel, and Perugius were having a nice chat. As the evening sunlight washed over them, they seemed to be enjoying their conversation. Luke and Sivaril waited nearby, though they weren't participating. They merely stood and listened in on Zenobia's conversation. "Master Elilise and I did get caught up in his attack, but I don't think there is another mage in the world that can use such a spell outside of my master."
I hear it resembled lightning," Perugius replied. "But if it was able to paralyze Atofi, as you say, it must have been quite potent."
"And what happened after that? How did the battle end?" Ariel asked.
"Unfortunately, I'm afraid I lost consciousness at that point, so I'm unable to..." "Ah! There's the man himself!"
Zenobia found me, so I had no other choice. I bowed and made my way toward their group.
"Good evening. Are you having a tea party?"
"Yes, master! Lord Perugius said he wanted to know how our battle with Atofi transpired, so I was explaining the finer details to him."
"I see." I glanced over at Perugius. He seemed to be in much better spirits than when we first had an audience with him.
"I heard that it was your magic that weakened Atofi so greatly, Rudius," he said.
"No, that was largely thanks to Zenobia locking her in place. If I had aimed my spell at her without his help, she may have deflected it."
"I see, yes." "That image of her still lingers in my mind." His face cracked into an obscene grin.
"Does he really hate Atofi that much? He was in a good mood."
"You seem to be quite chipper," I said.
"Of course I am. Never in my wildest dreams did I think I would get an opportunity to exact revenge on someone who has given me grief so many times. I have lost count."
"Revenge, you say?"
"Yes, a grudge, if you will, that's lasted a number of years."
He was probably referring to the war that happened 400 years ago, Laplace's war. Perugius was a young adventurer at the time, but he aided the humans fighting on the front lines. Atofi had also spearheaded some of the demons' forces, acting as a general. Perugius encountered her many times on the battlefield. Since he was young and inexperienced, he wasn't able to beat her, instead sustaining life-threatening injuries at each encounter. Two people who saved him back then, the dragon god Urupin, an older brother-type figure to Perugius, and north god Kalman. Perugius could only grit his teeth in frustration at each loss. He planned to eventually take revenge on Atofi, but then north god Kalman married her. When Kalman died, he made the two swear an oath that they wouldn't kill each other. Thus, Perugius never went back to the demon continent, destroying his chances for revenge. He had almost given up hope on ever striking back at Atofi, but this timing was more perfect. His timing was more perfect than he could have imagined. He took a shot at her without her coming after him in return. That was what had him on cloud nine.
"I must thank you for that," said Perugius. "You did a splendid job."
"Are you sure it's okay that you broke your oath with North God Kalman?"
"He forbade us from killing each other. I'm sure he wouldn't fuss over some one-sided pummeling."
Beating up a defenseless opponent for something they did centuries ago seemed pretty barbaric to me, although that spoke volumes about the depth of the grudge they shared.
"It appears I may have misjudged you a bit. I should give you some kind of reward," said Perugius.
"I don't really need a reward." No thanks. Count me out. I do not want power. Not like a Tofi offered.
Ah, yes. Once Nanahoshi finishes recovering, I will personally teach you how to use summoning magic.
I hesitated. I'm not going to be stuck here and unable to return home for the next decade if I agree to that, right?
Do not compare me to a Tofi.
Oh, well, as long as I could go home, there was no reason to refuse. I did want to know more about summoning and teleportation magic. Plus, I might face a similar crisis in the future. It wouldn't hurt to learn the other ways to fight, just in case. I wasn't fond of conflict, but in this world, you needed a modicum of strength to escape danger. I thought it would be enough to protect my family, but after the Hydra and what happened this time, it was clear I wasn't powerful enough. I wanted to think that situations where I would have to fight anything of that level were few and far between, but better safe than sorry. Lord Perugius? Do you think you could possibly do some training with me or teach me how to fight better? I don't mind if it's after the summoning lessons.
This was brought on by your encounter with a Tofi? Or are you not satisfied already with the power you possess?
Ah, crap. Now his mood is soured. This isn't good. It's nothing like that. I just thought it would be nice to have better options if I ever get into that kind of trouble again.
After a long pause, he said, Very well. I will give you an item so you can contact me. Sivaril?
He shot a look over at her. Sivaril produced a flute from her pocket, one that resembled a tower with a dragon wrapped around it.
If you use this in any place I have a connection to, Clear Knight of the Roaring Thunder will hear it, and Aramonfi will come see you.
I accepted the flute and tucked it away. It sounded like he would come to help me if I ever needed it. That wasn't a bad solution either.
Seems the sun has set.
I glanced back. The evening light had faded. Now the moon was hovering in the sky. Strangely enough, the area around us wasn't dark. That was thanks to the blue glow of the flowers in the garden gave... Oh, flowers in the garden gave off.
This table is made of illuminators, Perugius explained.
Go on, have a seat. Why don't we continue to chat for a bit? Obediently, I plopped down.
The dwarves' craftsmanship was really at its height prior to the second Great Human-Demon War.
Indeed.
If the dwarves hadn't lost their homeland during the conflict, they might still be making masterpieces now.
Perugius was actually an interesting fellow when she got to talking with him. He possessed great wisdom and loved the fine arts. He was also a man of culture who had an appreciation for creative work.
The dwarven race has endured, at least. They possess such dexterous hands. I am sure they will one day produce another craftsman capable of creating superb work. Speaking of which...
Oh. No, okay, so that was Zenoba.
The dwarven race has endured, at least. They possess such dexterous hands. I am sure they will one day produce another craftsman capable of creating superb work.
Speaking of which, Perugius said, redirecting the conversation...
I believe you said one of you was raising such a craftsman.
Zenoba nodded.
Yes! Though he may not look it, my master is deeply knowledgeable about figurines. We thought that if we taught a dwarf such techniques, we might achieve new heights. You did show me one of Rudius's figurines. It was quite interesting. It's incredible that he was able to create a replica of a person with such intricate detail.
The two of them were enjoying their conversation. Sadly, I lacked the level of knowledge they possessed, so I wasn't able to keep up with them. The discussion was still interesting enough to listen in on, though.
No, I said, you flatter me too much. No need to be humble, said Perugius. Agreed! Sylvie has told me many times how talented you are, Lord Rudius.
Okay, I just needed to know who was saying what. There was actually one more participant in our... Oh, no, okay, sorry.
Agreed. Sylvie has told me many times how talented you are, Lord Rudius.
Motherfucker. I thought I had it right from reading the whole sentence. Still got it wrong. There was actually one more participant in our tea party. While the other two merrily conversed with each other, she tried to jump in with her own suggestions and knowledge. Sadly, her attempts were fruitless. These two were so hardcore that she, like me, could not hope to keep up.
It's not just magic, Lord Rudius. Oh. It's not just magic. Lord Rudius is knowledgeable about the arts as well. He truly is an amazing person.
Thank you, Princess. Acting as a third wheel in the conversation was none other than Ariel Anamoy Asura. She desperately wanted Perugia's help, but she was at a loss on how to gain his favor. I smiled uncomfortably as she showered me with exaggerated praise. For the better part of the conversation, she had turned into a robot that awkwardly interested herself and parroted the same generic lines. It was obvious she had nothing of substance to add to their conversation.
She's got a long road ahead of her. Incidentally, Lord Perugius, we were thinking of putting some of these figurines on the market soon. Might we ask your honest opinion on the idea?
Zenoba blurted out. He reached for a box that he had left at his feet, one I had seen before.
Oh?
Intrigued, Perugius gazed at it. When Zenoba lifted the lid, however, his mood quickly soured.
A spurred figurine? I should have known you would recognize it at a mere glance.
Perugius' lips thinned. Zenoba lifted out Richard's figurine that Julie had made. Stylistically, it was a little different from the one I'd made, but the pose and overall design made it feel lifelike. That wasn't enough to satisfy Perugius, though.
You asked me this question knowing how I detest demons.
He stared at the Richard figure in disgust as he spat.
You had better give up any illusions you have about selling this thing.
Hopeless, as I expected. Perugius really did loathe demons. He was an otherwise tolerant person, but he held great prejudice against demons than anyone I had ever met. Zenoba should have known that showing a spurred figurine to someone like Perugius would only ruffle their feathers.
What was he playing at? Nonetheless, this model is the figurine of someone to whom you owe a debt, Lord Perugius,
said Zenoba.
A debt, you say?
Perugius frowned. After thinking for a moment, his eyes went wide.
Don't tell me you used Richard Spurdia as a model for this.
Yes, we did. You've told me that in your last battle with Laplace, it was Lord Richard who assisted you.
The words rolled smoothly off Zenoba's tongue. He wasn't bringing this up on the fly. The two of them had enjoyed a number of tea parties without me. Zenoba must have gotten that information out of Perugius previously. Now I could see where this was going, and it gave me hope.
Of course, I am perfectly aware of your distaste for demons. However, I also believe that if my master's skills had some public exposure, this type of craftsmanship would take the world by storm. Wouldn't you like to see that happen? Imagine it, a splendid world overflowing with art.
Perugius pulled a face. We were so close to convincing him. Maybe I should hop into the conversation, too.
I hate the spurred. They move in the darkness, massacring innocent lives. Though it is also true that without Richard's help, I wouldn't be alive today. However,
Lord Perugius, Richard regrets the things he did in the past, too, I blurted.
He does.
Perugius tilted his head. Now, how should I best explain this?
Yes, Laplace deceived him.
Okay, I had an email that went off. Okay, cool. I'm just going to ignore that.
Laplace, you say?
Perugius' face clouded over. Looks like this is a good direction. That's right. Laplace gave him a spear that robbed him of his senses. Richard was manipulated into dishonoring his entire clan. Worse, he even killed his own family. Now he feels ashamed of himself and hates Laplace for what he did. Perugius listened quietly.
That's why he's traveling the world right now, looking for a way to restore honor to his people. This plan of ours is one way we can help him with his endeavor. I also owe Richard a great debt.
If you're grateful for the help he provided you, then I hope you'll approve of what we're doing.
As a way to repay him,
Perugius folded his arms, closed his eyes, and furrowed his brows. After a long silence, he finally said,
I care not for the spurred and their reputation, but I must honor my debts.
Oh, then
do as you like.
Although he wasn't pleased, Perugius had acquiesced at least. Now we could sell our Richard figurines without fear of Armanfi appearing out of nowhere, destroying our shop,
In fact, if someone disapproved of our doing so, we could tell them that Perugius had given us his permission. I had no idea how much weight his name carried, but it was sure to be handy, given his fame. Anyway, Zenoba sure made a persuasive argument, being able to wriggle his way through such a difficult topic. He was definitely impressing me more and more lately. I needed to learn from his example.
We appreciate your consideration.
Both Zenoba and I bowed our heads. I just felt it was more appropriate for Zenoba to say it, because I can't do two voices at once. All right. So. Crap. Okay. Both Zenoba and I bowed our heads. We were one step closer to selling these figurines to the public. Just wait a bit longer for me, Rejard.
While we're on the topic, Master, why don't you give Lord Perugius a taste of your skill?
Zenoba smacked his palm as if the idea had just occurred to him.
My skill? You know, your specialty, to make these figurines out of nothing.
I glanced over at Perugius, who nodded me in approval.
Show me. I'm interested in this magic of yours.
And so started my real-time demonstration of making a figurine. I did the same thing I always did, use earth magic to create the general shape, then chip away at each part until the overall figurine came together. This time I decided to create one around the size of a Nendoroid figure. A figurine. It made things easier and meant I could finish it quickly. The quality wouldn't be the best, but at least the parts were simple to construct. I created a bird's mask over the figurine's face. This would be Sivereal's figure.
This is Sivereal. You're quite dexterous.
Perugius' eyes were fixed on me as I worked, closely observing each step. He seemed greatly interested. I wondered if he could actually see my mana, or maybe he just sensed how I was manipulating it. He was a legendary hero, after all.
I never dreamed anyone could use earth magic in such a way.
If you have a request, I can make anything you want, I offered.
Very well. In that case, bring me one high-quality figurine you make, and I will buy it from you.
Nice. Now we had a regular customer. Considering we had no idea where Batty Gatty had disappeared to, securing another business opportunity like this was important.
In that case, Ariel spoke up, joining the conversation.
We also have some splendid craftsmen back in the Osira Kingdom. She went on with a spiel about how skilled the craftspeople were and promised she would have a statue of Perugius installed once she had once she took the throne. The whole time she rambled, Perugius looked annoyed. When she was done, he spat,
Osira's craftsmen only create works to satisfy the vanity of nobility. There is nothing interesting about their art at all.
What? Ariel was struck speechless. As if to hammer the nail further into the coffin, Perugius continued,
If you truly do become king, will you not have more important things to do than create a statue of me?
Well, I...
Perugius cut her off. Or is misappropriating the people's taxes to live in luxury your definition of being king?
No, not at all. My apologies, I spoke out of turn. Please forget I said anything.
Ariel dropped her gaze, trying to backpedal. It was hard to believe this dejected person normally overflowed with charisma and confidence.
Still,
the way Perugius coldly rebuffed her was uncalled for. Did he really hate her that much?
Had what she said really gotten under his skin that badly?
Wait, Ariel Anamoy Osira.
Perugius called out as she tried to slink away. His oppressive gaze bore into her.
What does being king mean to you? What does a true king possess?
Well, they're wise, listen to their cabinet members, and don't forget their position in society.
Wrong. Perugius shook his head, not even letting her finish. The Osirin king I knew was a true king, but he was nothing like you describe.
Which king?
The man who took the throne in the wake of Laplace's war. My sworn friend. Gonest Frien Osira.
I had heard a bit about King Gonest before. He was the last surviving member of the Osirin royal family after Laplace's war. He became a great ruler who brought the country together after it was ravaged during the conflict. The fighting took a great toll on the Osirin lands, but his skills as a monarch kept the country from descending into civil war. I have heard that King Ganus was a great ruler. I doubt I could ever follow in his footsteps. Perugius shook his head. He was not great. He was a coward who hated conflict and was always running away. He couldn't study to save his life, possessed no skill in battle, and he was always sneaking out to some pub to ogle the women there. He had no ambition to take the throne, but he had the most important quality a ruler can have. That, I believe, is what made him a true king.
What quality was that?
If you can bring me that answer yourself, then I will give you my support.
Ah, so this is the trial he intends to give her.
He's testing Ariel to see if she's someone deserving of his assistance or not.
The most important quality a king can have, Ariel echoed, stroking her chin as she stared at the table, which was probably trying to remember the story she had heard of King Ganus.
Sounds to me the guy was just a complete idiot, or maybe he was a genius in disguise, similar to Oda Nobunaga?
Rudius, Perugius turned to me. What do you think? I'm afraid I would have no idea how to answer the question, given I'm not royalty.
What a dull reply. You don't have to contemplate the answer, just say whatever comes to mind.
That's still kind of a tall order. King, huh? What was a king supposed to be in the first place? I knew they appeared a lot in fantasy stories, but what did they actually do?
There was someone at the top, a country's ruler, like a prime minister, I knew that, but to be honest, I didn't really have much of an interest in politics, even in my previous life. All I did was look at how other people online reacted to politicians and follow their lead.
Personally, I think I'd prefer a ruler who can put themselves in the shoes of the common folk rather than someone who relies on their own abilities.
Ha ha! Perugius exhaled, seemingly impressed by my bland answer. Ariel, this boy just gave me a much better reply than you.
After a pause, she argued,
But a person cannot be king if they only ever think of the people.
True. It's not as though Ganus only ever thought about the people either. However, those around him did lend him their help, and he was able to suppress the potential for uprisings in Asura.
So you're saying a king's own abilities are meaningless?
Is that what you think? Is a country who makes an imbecile their ruler a good country in your eyes?
Ariel's expression contorted with sadness and frustration.
What exactly was Perugius trying to get her to say?
I had no idea. Well, not that I really needed to. I had no designs on the throne.
Perhaps Perugius was actually trying to test Ariel's determination and character. Maybe there wasn't a correct answer.
Still, is a king so great that he's worth going through all this trouble to become one?
You should think long and hard about this, Ariel Anemoi Asura. After a brief pause, Perugius said, Now then, it is late. Why don't we return to the fortress?
With that, our tea party was over. I would long remember the way Ariel looked as we made our way back inside. Her shoulders slumped forward as she shuffled along with Luke close at her heels.
That's chapter 9. We are now 82% of the way through.
232 out of the 287 pages left.
We're moving right along. Ugh.
I don't think we have a lot of exercises redeemed. Yeah. Oh, God, we only have 2 exercises. Yeah. All right, so we're going right to the next chapter. Goody. Good stuff. Chapter 10, Turning Point.
Part 4. The days flew by after that. Once Sylphie had sufficiently recovered, we returned to Sharia. The sun was setting by the time we arrived at the house. I felt strangely nostalgic standing in front of our estate, even though only a few days had passed since I last saw it.
Oh, yeah, sure. Now you guys start redeeming.
We're home.
Yeah, welcome home. Hey, wait, it's Big Brother.
The moment we burst in through the front door, Aisha came scrambling into the front room. She looked utterly dumbfounded, which wasn't surprising after the speech I gave about possibly being away from home for a long time.
Are you done already? Did you save Miss Nanahoshi, or was it hopeless? Aisha asked anxiously.
I reached over and ruffled her hair. Whoa, hey! Aisha gasped, sounding like a bad actor reading a line from a script. She didn't look the least bit displeased by my display of affection. What's with you all of a sudden? Nothing. Nanahoshi's fine now. I'll explain in a minute. Is Roxy already home? What about Norn? Norn is still at school. Miss Roxy's in her room, I think. As for my She paused and corrected herself. Mom, Miss Lilia, I mean, is doing the laundry. Mother, Lady Zenith, is resting now. All right, so Norn is at school. Sorry to add more to your plate, but could you fetch Roxy?
Aye, aye, Captain.
A few minutes later, Roxy came down the stairs. She must have been nodding off at her desk because her hair was a disheveled mess and there was a red print on her cheek.
Welcome home, Rudy. How did it go?
I'm about to explain that, but before I do, I slipped my hands under her arms and lifted her, wrapping her tightly in my embrace. We did promise that I would do this when I came home. Although initially caught off guard, Roxy gingerly looped her arms around me and returned the hug.
Welcome home.
I'm glad to be back.
After that whirlwind adventure, I was finally home. And that's what happened. I recounted everything to them. It was a lot. I didn't go into thorough detail, but I did include everything pertinent. I took particular time in relaying everything I learned in relation to Zenith's curse. We would need to keep a careful eye on her. I'll continue staying at the Floating Fortress for now, but I'll come home at least once every 3 days, I said. Ariel and Sylphie were also going to stay at the fortress until their efforts came to fruition. Sylphie also intended to return home every few days. None of us would be able to attend school, but, well, as long as we showed up for homeroom, surely it would be fine. I hadn't taken any classes lately.
Very well, Lord Rudeus, I shall take proper care of the house and Zenith in your absence, so you need not worry, Lilia assured me. I had put quite the burden on her shoulders. Anyway, that was the end of my report. Our family meeting was adjourned.
Sorry about that. Wow, just all over.
Phew, I'm completely pooped, said Sylphie. I think I'm going to rest. What about you, Rudeus?
I'm going to hit the sack after taking a bath. Should I wait in bed for you?
Nah, don't worry about it today. All right.
And with that, I left Sylphie to rest. I realized I'd had nothing but cold baths for the past few days. I missed soaking in warm water. I headed straight for the bath and used my magic to warm the liquid in it. Manual water warming robot Roombus. Activate! I really should rinse myself off before I hop in, but oh well. I peeled off my clothes and slid into the bath. Whew! The steamy hot water enveloped me and I could feel the fatigue draining from my body. I hadn't fully realized how much these past 10 days had taken out of me. Still, 10 days. It's hard to believe it's only been that long since we went to Perugius's castle. So much had happened in that short span of time. Nanahoshi fainted, then we went to the demon continent, met Kishirika, and royally pissed off Atofi. Atofi sure was strong. I got the feeling I could never defeat her. It was foolish to even consider besting an opponent of her level. I was surprised my electricity magic had actually worked against her. Perhaps I had a chance as long as my opponent let down their guard. Sorry. Maybe it would be worth doing more research to hone my magic. At least so that, even if I was surrounded by water, I wouldn't get hit with the effects of my own spell. At the moment, I had no idea how I could avoid that. What if I covered my body in rubber, like Stretch Man from that kid's TV show? Atofi's subordinate, Moore, was pretty tough, too. No matter what spell I threw at him, he always seemed to have a counter. It was like he knew all of the magic that existed and how to defend against it. Up till now, the only other strong mage I knew was Roxy. But she was more of an expert in facing monsters. This was the first time I had ever seen someone who was an expert in fighting other human opponents. Maybe as long as I had disturbed magic in my prosthetic arm, I could find a way to deal with an enemy like that. There really wasn't a given strategy for facing strong opponents like him. Regardless, if there were people that powerful all around the world, I really needed to work on getting stronger. I never thought I'd be matched against opponents like that, but I'd really been running into them every few years. There was just one issue. How was I supposed to get stronger? I apparently wasn't able to use battle aura, so there was a limit to how much I could train myself physically. Still, it didn't matter if I was physically weak as long as I could triumph over my opponent. In that case, maybe I was heading in the right direction by learning summoning magic from Perugius. If I kept switching gears without deciding on a solid path, I would wind up being a lackluster jack-of-all-trades. Okay, Spider, the reason you're almost out of points is because you don't show up and comment enough on these. You want to build up points? Be active. That's the most I can say. Be active in the chat, bro. That's how you build up points. That's the most consistent, fast way to do it. So, yeah. All right. All right. If I kept switching gears without deciding on a solid path, I would wind up being a... Okay. I knew that firsthand from my previous life. Although there was so much going on in this world and so many possibilities that it was actually beneficial to pick up a wide range of skills, I preferred this to how it was in Japan, where you had to pick a single profession and stick to it your whole life. Oh yeah, I'd also like to learn how to draw teleportation circles. That way, if anything like this happens again, I can get away quickly. Knowledge is power, after all. Having a way to communicate long distance would also be nice. Ariel lent us her rings, but we didn't end up using them. Perhaps we could enhance them so they could send simple messages back and forth. While they probably wouldn't work everywhere in the world, they could at least be something like a pager. Let's see, what else was there? I was pretty sure something else came to mind when I went to the Demon Continent. Ah, this always happens, I grumbled. I was always forgetting things. I would come up with an idea, swear to myself I would do it later, and then come up with something else and completely forget the other plans I'd had in my head. I wanted to think I had a pretty good memory, but it sure was failing me a lot. Crap, if I keep going like this, I might end up making the same mistakes again and again. I was lucky that things turned out well this time, but I might not be so fortunate the next. If I couldn't remember what I needed to work on, I wouldn't be able to address my weaknesses before the next unforeseen incident. Okay, but what should I do then? After a long moment of thinking, it struck me. That's it! I remember someone telling me I should write things down if you want to remember them. All right. Guess I should start a diary then. The idea sounded even better after I said it out loud. I could record the details of what happened, what I'd learned, what I'd needed to work on, and anything else I needed. Then I could come up with a solution, decide what to prioritize first, make a clear goal, and select my next objective. By doing so, I would no longer have to rely on luck, and I could reflect upon my screw-ups so they didn't happen again. This would decrease my chances of repeating past mistakes. That would lead to less serious blunders in the long term as well. Admittedly, keeping a diary wasn't a guarantee that everything would go perfectly, but it wasn't a bad place to start. Yeah, I think this will work out great. Well then, let's get writing. Right now! With that thought in mind, I leaped out of the bath. Although they don't actually sell diaries here. I toweled myself off before heading to my study. I sank down in my chair and extracted a sheaf of papers from the bottom of my shelf. While it might not be a bound diary, I could still write on them just the same. Recording things was the most important part, but just writing on some loose leaf paper is a bit depressing. Let's make a little project out of this. Not that starting in style was the be-all end-all, but it couldn't hurt to dress up the appearance of my new diary. I gathered up some loose papers and placed them on my desk. I used magic to punch holes through the edge. Then I used my earth magic to create rings to insert through them. Next, I needed 3 boards and a hinge, I could throw them all together in book form. I could throw them all together in book form so they could open with my sheets of bound paper inside. And with that, my binder-style diary was complete. How much do you think it cost me? Nothing. Completely DIY. Okay, well, the paper did cost money. Wonder if anyone here could buy a hole puncher if I made one for sale. It was worth writing down, at least. If I didn't note all my ideas, I'd eventually forget them. So how do you go about constructing a hole puncher? No, I had more important things to write down first. Where should I start? How long had it been since I last kept a diary? When I was a shut-in in my previous life, I tried one of those text websites, but I didn't keep up with it for very long. I might go down that same path if I wasn't conscientious about this. Unfortunately, this body of mine was pretty receptive to routines. Sorry, it's not unfortunately, motherfricker. Fortunately, this body of mine was pretty receptive to routines, so I would probably do it automatically as long as I made it a habit. Okay, I should probably stop that. It sounds weird to talk about this body in the third person as if it's not my own. What I should have said was, I'm the type who does things diligently as long as I make them a habit, so it shouldn't be a problem. Much better. As I had that inward back and forth, I started scribbling down the events from the past 10 days. I was yawning by the time I finished. Before I knew it, I was overcome with drowsiness. The area around me was all white. There was nothing but an utter lack of color. I knew this place well. I had seen it when Perugius used his teleportation magic to warp me through space. But where exactly was I? I had never given it that much thought before, but I started to wonder if this was an actual place somewhere in this world. That aside, I wish I wouldn't return to this form every time I came here. I was back in the body I had before I reincarnated. Back to when I was hopeless, overweight, shut-in. I had no intention of avoiding the truth that this was once my life, but it still disgusted me. I didn't look like this while Perugius was transporting me. Heya! All of a sudden, he was there. His blank white face had a thin smile on it, a mosaic layered over him. In the instant I saw him, it was like the memory of what he looked like was wiped from my mind. It was the man god. Been a while. Yeah, sure brings back memories. Guess it's been 2 years, huh? Has it been that long? The last time I got your advice was before I headed off to the Beggarit continent. So yeah, 2 years. That's not that long, though. When I was an adventurer, you didn't show your face once in 3 years. Now there's some nostalgia. I was quite the degenerate, but now there's some nostalgia. I was quite the degenerate back then. Yeah, you seem to be doing comparatively well for yourself now. Guess so. I got married, and I'm getting along well with my family. Definitely enjoying my life way more this time around. You got to know Perugius as well, I see. Perugius, huh? He sure is amazing. In my previous life, I would never have dreamed I'd someday meet someone like him. And he took a liking to me, too. You know, he said he'd buy a figure off of me if I made a good one. I never got close to a level where I could sell my stuff before I reincarnated here. Atofi also took a liking to you. Yeah, that one I'm much less happy about. Although I guess my training has paid off if she was that interested in me. I've worked on my physical strength and my magical skills. If Roxy had never taught me king-tier water magic, I would have been in some serious trouble this time. My electric spell was pretty effective against her, against Atofi and her guard. It sure was. That magic you used was incredible. I'm sure you could even use that against Orsted. Against Orsted? There isn't much magic out there in the world that can ignore battle aura and paralyze a person's body. That makes sense. I guess people here don't have a way to defend against electric shocks. But still, this is Orsted we're talking about. He'll just use disturbed magic to render my magic ineffective. Even if your power doesn't outmatch your opponent, that doesn't mean you can't still claim victory. You have a point. Wait, no, impossible. Me being able to use a bit of strange magic does not change the fact that Orsted would flatten me like a pancake. Besides, I have no interest in fighting him. I have nothing against the guy. Oh, really? Anyway, you really helped me back during the whole Beggarit ordeal. I'd be lying if I said I didn't have any regrets, but it wasn't all bad, although I didn't end up following your advice. Well, that was your choice. Just out of curiosity, what would have happened if I didn't go? If you didn't go, your father would have found some way to save your mother, and he wouldn't have died. On top of that, you would have had two beastfolk princesses to yourself and lived happily ever after.
What the hell? So you're saying he only died because I went?
That's right. Because you were there, he was determined to show off in front of you, and that's what screwed everything up.
Okay, but still, that can't...
If you had left things alone, he would have gathered his comrades to save your mother. Roxy, too, of course.
So, what? You're saying everything I did was pointless? And hey, when I got to her, Roxy was almost at death's door. I find it hard to believe she would have been fine without my involvement.
She really would have been fine without you. She was fated to survive, after all.
What do you mean by that? What is this fate crap? Explain yourself. Remember that merchant you saved?
If you hadn't been there, his delivery would have been greatly delayed. The day he arrived, a certain adventurer went walking around the marketplace and bought his merchandise, magic stones. However, if the merchant hadn't arrived, that man would have bought something else.
Such as what?
Such as a map of the teleportation labyrinth.
Oh, come on! Why are they even selling something that conspicuously convenient?
After failing to entice people to join him at the guild, Geese would have come up with a scheme to bolster their numbers so they could conquer the labyrinth. In the process, he'd sell a map of the teleportation labyrinth for cheap.
Now I get it. You're saying he'd sell the map he made.
It's true that there are a few people who would want to go in with Paul and the others, but there might be some who would think they could navigate it themselves. So you're saying the guy who bought the map would gather up his comrades, go into the labyrinth, and save Roxy?
Precisely.
He would run into your father there at the entrance, and they would all go in together. As luck would have it, they would find Roxy, too. And you're saying that because they would have more people with them, it would make it easier for them to get through the labyrinth than they would have been able to rescue my mother?
Correct.
Although, it would have taken them much longer than it did. About 2 years, to be precise. Since it's been about that long since you went, it'd be right about now they'd be getting her out of here. Oh, out of there. That's kind of hard for me to believe. It all seems way too convenient.
Maybe, but such is the way of fate.
All right. I guess you have a point. They do say truth is stranger than fiction. I guess that means it would have been better if I hadn't been there.
Damn it, that's depressing.
Although if that happened, I guess I wouldn't have been able to marry Roxy.
True.
She would have fallen for the man who rescued her instead, although he would have turned her down.
Well, doesn't seem so bad when you think of it that way. I do love Roxy, after all.
Though it did result in Paul's death. It makes me feel pretty conflicted to think I had to lose him so I could get married to Roxy.
It's not like I regret our marriage, just that if I had a similar relationship with Lenny and Persina, I imagine I would have been happy with that outcome, too. Not that I'm fine with being partners with just anyone, but if I had gone down that route, I probably wouldn't have known any better. Wouldn't have known that I could have been with Roxy instead. Ah, damn it. It's in the past. Let me get some water. It's in the past now.
Yeah, you're right. Regrets won't do me any good. I decided to go to Beggarit, and that's it. Right now, I'm happy. The choice I made might have been a mistake, but that doesn't change how things are now. I have regrets, but I don't think it was all bad.
You sure are optimistic.
Anyway, what's the reason for your visit today? Something else troubling coming my way?
Well, nothing too big. It's less advice and more like a favor.
A favor? From you? Now that's unusual. You've never asked me for anything before. Even I sometimes need to call in a favor. Okay then.
What is it? Say it.
Doesn't seem like it would be bad to listen to what you have to say and follow your advice every now and then. I think I've been a little too distrusting of you.
Oh, really? Pleases me to hear you say that.
Well, you have gone to great lengths to help me.
In fact, I feel bad for doubting you so much before. I just thought you were getting your kicks from watching me suffer. That's why I acted that way.
You wound me. Giving my name, you should realize I'm a god after all. True, I do get bored and want to watch when something entertaining is going down, but I'm not in the habit of leading people astray just to take pleasure from their misery.
Yeah, I thought so too. There aren't many people like that.
Agreed.
So, what is it you want me to do?
Nothing too important. I just want you to go down to your basement when you wake up. Check to make sure nothing is odd down there. If you don't see anything, then don't worry about it.
Anything odd? Why would...
No, never mind. I got it. I won't question you this time. I'll just do it. Hehe. All right, then. You have my thanks.
As my consciousness began to fade out, a sickening smile split across the man god's face. My eyes cracked open. A candle flickered at the edge of my vision. I glanced through the skylight and saw the moon in the sky. There were no other sounds. The house was silent. I had fallen asleep in the midst of writing my diary. A bit of drool had dribbled down my chin and onto the half-written page.
Yes, I'll be rewriting this.
I ripped the page out and left it on the corner of my desk. I'd copy what I had written on the new sheet later.
I wonder how long I was asleep for. My body feels so sluggish. It's like I've been out for days.
As I got up, something fell from my shoulder. A blanket. Sylphie or Roxy must have draped it over me. Whoever it was, I appreciated the gesture.
All right, then.
I remembered the contents of my dream. The man god had told me to go check out the basement.
Kind of weird advice.
Regardless, I felt there was nothing wrong with going along with it. He had never steered me wrong in the past, so I was compelled to fulfill his wishes, occasionally. It would benefit both of us. Plus, the man god must be tired of me mouthing off every time he tried to give me advice. Why did I see I? I'm just so dumb. Even if our relationship was the give and take sort, it would behoove me to get along with him in case I ever needed his help. As I made to head for the basement, I let out a huge sneeze.
Achoo!
Whew, sure is cold. The spring was still far off and snow continued to blanket the ground, so it was chilly. I shouldn't have let myself doze off here. I needed to hurry up and get to bed so I could cuddle under a warm blanket. I grabbed my robe off the hook on the wall where it had been hanging and pulled it over my arms. I wonder what time it is right now. It had to be around midnight, considering I didn't hear any other sounds in the house. If I sneaked into either Roxy or Sylphie's bedroom and slid under the covers with them, they would probably cry out in surprise. I didn't mind if we didn't have sex. I just wanted some warmth. In fact, I just felt real lonely right now. It was probably thanks to the man god. I should never have asked him what would have happened if I hadn't gone to beggar it. No, I'm the one who asked. It's my fault. And if all the blame lies with me, I should just sleep alone. I was preoccupied with those thoughts as I nudged the door open. I suddenly sensed a presence behind me and whipped around. All I saw was the empty chair I'd left behind. No one was there. Of course not. Must have been my imagination. The only things in the room were a desk, a chair, and a bookshelf. There was nowhere for anyone to hide. There was a window, but it wasn't large enough for someone to sneak in and out of. The only entrance was the door I was standing in front of. The room was small enough that one candle was enough to illuminate every nook and cranny. The only person who could possibly be in here was me. And why did I think someone else was here, even though it's practically impossible? Despite my skepticism, I continued to sense a presence in the room. It was odd. Maybe there was a bug under my bookshelf or something?
Huh?
Something about it was off-putting. My heart beat erratically. Was it anxiety? What was it I was feeling anxious about? Well, whatever. I'll just hurry to the basement and take a look. I pulled the door open the rest of the way and started out, and then I initially spun back around and exclaimed, "Aha! Now I've got you!" There was no logic to my actions. I'd just done it on a whim. I was only trying to reassure myself that no one was there, yet... Lo and behold, Someone was there.
Huh?
A man in a tattered old robe sat in my chair, the only chair in the room. He was aged, wrinkles lining his face, hair white as snow, the beginnings of a beard covering his chin, giving the impression that he didn't invest much in his appearance. He had the air of a seasoned veteran, but there was something rough and unrefined about him, like he had come out of a long, long battle. The light in his eyes was sharp, and the color of his right and left pupil differed from one another. His lips trembled in surprise.
So, I succeeded?
He glanced around, eyes narrowing as his expression filled with emotion. However, he then looked at his hand and touched his stomach and flinched. His smile turned self-deprecating.
Ah, this is a failure. Yes, there was no hope of me succeeding. I felt like I had seen him somewhere before, but I had no recollection of him. There was something familiar, though, as if he resembled someone. Who could it be? Paul, maybe? No, not him. Soros, then? But he didn't exude the same level of boldness as Soros. This old man seemed much more timid.
Do you see what I see?
Sorry, I just could not resist. Alrighty. Who are you? Are you the man god, perhaps? The moment I said that name, his eyes turned toward me and went wide. I recognized that reaction. Orsted had the same over-exaggerated response when I said that name. They were the same, yet this man looked nothing like Orsted. No. He slowly shook his head, staring straight into my eyes. There was strength in his gaze. He refused to look away. It was like I was being sucked in, almost like I was staring into a mirror. The old man gazed at the door behind me and frowned. He pointed a gnarled, bony finger at it, and the door slammed shut. I jumped at the sound it made. How did he do that? Confused, I turned toward him. There was a glint in his eye as he glared back at me. Don't go down to the basement. You're being deceived by the man god.
What? Deceived? What was he talking about? I didn't understand. Hold on. Hold on a second there. Who the heck are you, and how did you get in here?
I am... He opened his mouth to speak, but suddenly closed it. After a moment of contemplation, he finally said, I am... The name gave me a shock, the likes of which I had never felt before. I was the only person in the world who knew that name. It was one I would take to the grave without ever sharing it with anyone else, or with anything else. One I wanted to forget. One that shouldn't exist in this world. My name, from my previous life. I came from the future, he said.
And that's chapter 10, bitches. That's turning point 4.
So, yeah, it is the big thing right there is that. So there you go. All right, we're going to keep going. I know I have a full house, but I'm going to keep going, and we're going to finish chapter 11, and I'm going to do my exercises toward the end. So now that we have a full house, we're taking more, and that more will be... So here's the thing. Mods, or actually in this case, Rage, you can either keep everything as it is, but we know everything's at 40, or you can remove everything, say that it's either been redeemed, rejected, blah, 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 blah. And people can start over from the beginning to set up another 40. We have overspills. Good. Overspills will count. I'll do everything that I possibly can once we're done reading. But yeah, you guys can add up and we'll see how broken I become from all of this. I am testing out a thing where I just continue reading and then I do my exercises at the end. That way, I don't spend so much time waiting on myself to be able to catch my breath again. So, this may not be how we move forward from now on. Again, I'm just testing stuff out, so we're not 100% sure. Man, I missed a couple of hairs underneath my chin with my... Okay, I'll freaking get them later. Okay.
Chapter 11, An End and a Beginning. The old man came from the future. That was what he said. Honestly, I didn't understand what he meant. True, he did kind of look like me. The future. So you're me from the future?
That's right. I'm you, about 50 years from now.
He sure didn't beat around the bush, but it was also sudden. I didn't know if I should believe him or not. On the other hand, he did know my name. I had never mentioned it to anyone, and I never would. Maybe there was a way to use magic to read a person's mind. Having said that, I did reincarnate into this world with all of my memories intact. It wasn't that far-fetched to think time travel might exist, too. I had no way of distinguishing whether he was telling the truth or not.
Sorry, but I don't have time to explain the ins and outs of time travel magic to you, he said.
What do you mean by that?
Exactly what I said. I know it sounds like a phrase straight out of a Hollywood film, but I really don't have much time. You need to listen.
He made the Hollywood reference without missing a beat. It meant he had to have some connection to my previous life. Maybe he really was me from the future. There was a glint in his eyes and a darkness lurking within. Frankly, he looked like someone who killed people daily. There was such a coldness to his gaze, as if he cared very little about other people's lives. Was this the person I was destined to become in the future? It couldn't be. It was too hard to believe, yet the expression on his face was earnest.
Okay, let's just assume that he is me 50 years from now and at least listen to what he has to say.
There is nothing in the basement, he blurted out. At least, I went down there and thought there was nothing. I felt at ease in the following days because the man god said there was nothing to worry about if I didn't find anything. The old man's face contorted in disgust. But I was wrong, and I can tell you why now. He tapped a finger, his left index finger, against his forehead, as if recalling the incident.
Wait, what? Is that a regular hand?
Listen up. I think there's probably a rat down in the basement. A sick one. It probably has purple teeth, almost like a magic stone. I have no idea where it came from and when it got down there. Most likely it sneaked into my luggage while I was in Perugius's floating fortress. It doesn't really matter where it came from, though. The old man opened his hand and smacked his fist against it. You'll startle the rat when you go down there, and it'll run to the kitchen. There, it'll rummage through the leftover food you've got sitting out. Aisha will find it dead there the next day and dispose of it. I remained silently and simply listened. Aisha will get rid of the leftovers by feeding them to a stray cat. His left hand isn't a prosthetic. Is this guy really me after all? Or did he find some way to restore his lost arm and in the intervening 50 years? However, before then, Roxy will get peckish and come downstairs to grab a little bite of those leftovers. As a result, she'll contract the same illness the rat carried.
What? Roxy will get sick?
The mention of her name brought my focus back to the conversation. Petrification syndrome. I felt like I had heard that name before.
That's right. It's supposed to be an illness that one can only cure with god-tier detoxification magic.
It was an incurable disease that would slowly turn the infected into magic stone.
But where exactly did I hear of it?
We didn't realize at first. After all, it's exceedingly rare for someone to be infected with petrification syndrome. The pathogens can only take refuge within a life budding inside another person.
Wait, do you mean?
Yes, an unborn child. The disease only affects pregnant women. I was shocked when I discovered that later.
What? But Roxy isn't...
She is pregnant, he said. But that's not surprising. The two of you have had sex. It's only natural.
Wait, Roxy is pregnant?
Wow, it was extremely joyous news, and yet it was being delivered in the grimmest way possible. For some reason, some rats are resistant to the disease and act as carriers of petrification syndrome. You'll recognize them at a glance. Their teeth have turned into purple crystals. They transfer pathogens to anything they bite into.
It can only be orally transmitted, and the pathogens don't survive for very long after leaving their host. It takes half a day at most before they die out. Plus, it's not very contagious since only pregnant women are affected. The pathogens take up resistance inside the fetus and transform it, thereby turning the mother's body into stone. And Roxy was going to come down with this disease? If you carelessly go down to the basement and drive that rodent out, Aisha will complain to you the following day that she found strange rat remains in the house. 2 weeks later, you'll hear about a cat who is infected by petrification syndrome. Roxy will come down with a fever shortly after. I hesitated before finally asking, and what will happen to her? She will die. His reply was so blunt and to the point that it left me speechless. Roxy will slowly lose her mobility until she's confined to a bed. Her feet will begin to turn to stone, and it's then you realize she has petrification syndrome. And she never got better during your time? Didn't you try to cure her? Sadness washed over his face as his eyes dropped to the floor. I was so desperate to help her, I even went to the holy country of Milis. I learned the incantation necessary to cure her, but so much happened along the way, and it took me too much time. When I finally got back, it was too late. Her body was already halfway gone, and she was dead. No, that can't be. He immediately lifted his head, that fierce glint back in his eyes as he stared me down. The incident will be linked to something that happens 30 years from now. It's all because of what the man god says. Don't be misled by him. You have memories of your previous life, so you should understand. He is the root of all evil in this world, the final boss. But why is he after Roxy? I still don't know the answer to that. However, I do know that he is moving with some objective in mind. The last thing he said to me was this. Thanks to you for being such an idiot. Everything went down as planned. Thanks to you being such an idiot, everything went exactly as I planned. He clenched his teeth. Damn it. The man god actually said that? Still, As for what his goal is, maybe Orsted or Laplace might know. I didn't get a chance to meet them these 50 years. There's a high chance you won't be able to either, even if you look. Even Nanahoshi didn't have a clue where to find him? At the mention of her name, his face sank. Maybe she really didn't know. I never asked her, but maybe you could give it a try. Even if she doesn't know exactly where he is, she is intelligent enough to think of all kinds of contingencies. So she may be able to come up with something. What ended up happening to Nanahoshi? His lips thinned, and he didn't answer. The sad look on his face said all I needed to know already. But after a pause, he finally replied, at the very, very end, she failed. I messed up trying to comfort her, and then... So she never managed to make it home? She must have fallen into despair and taken her own life? Okay, I don't need to hear anymore. Yeah, I don't want to talk about it either. He lifted his chin, trying to regain his composure. There is something else, and it's actually important. There is something else, and it's important. You'll learn about this 10 years from now, but the man god isn't actually called that here. What do you mean? He's a god of humans. In other words, the god of men. Everyone who's heard of him knows him that way, as the god of men. Only those who've actually met him know his name, the man god. Why he's chosen to refer to himself that way is beyond me. I assume it's his way of messing with people. That made sense. So that is why some people, Orsted, had such an exaggerated reaction to the name. The only people who knew it were those who had met him and been deceived by him. On the surface, he only seemed to say things that benefited me. The old man clenched his hand again. Hatred burned like a raging fire in his eyes. Intense bloodlust radiated off. And yet, for some reason, I didn't find it terrifying. He hasn't told you a lie yet, up until this point, not as far as you, can tell. His fist began to shake. Something sparked inside of it,
crackling like electricity. But it was all for one purpose, to make someone as guarded as you let your defenses down so that you would obey him without question. Although I stared in mute amazement at the spark shooting from his hand, I also steeled myself in case he tried anything.
Don't be a fool. You've read manga, haven't you? You know that the people who talk about trust the most are the ones who always tell lies.
Yeah, I know that, but
he spat back. No, you know nothing. After you lose Roxy, you'll lose Sylphie next. You'll be so broken in the wake of Roxy's death that you won't even think about her for a while. Hurt by this, she'll fall into depression. The man god will take that opportunity to manipulate Luke.
Luke? Seriously?
Yes. Afterward, you'll hear about it from the girl who was dating him at the time. She'll say he suddenly woke up one morning in a panic, claiming to have heard the word of God.
And what happens after that?
Luke counsels Ariel to make haste to Asura. Sylphie abandons you to go with them. After having failed to garner Perugius' support, Ariel is at a disadvantage. She hedges her slim chance at victory on starting a civil war. But she is defeated, and Sylphie dies in battle.
Sylphie dies?
You're going to lose them both. The man shook his head, grinding his teeth together. I can still hear the man god's voice when he revealed all this trickery to me. The high-pitched laughter, the way his hand felt as he clapped me on the shoulder and told me, "Nice work." Damn it. Fuck. He slammed his fist on my desk. Electricity sparked around him, flashing bright as the midray sun. The light vanished in an instant, but the burn marks on my desk remained. Having finally regained his composure, the old man let out a steady breath. I'll say it again. Do not trust him. You will regret it. After he finished speaking, the old man clutched his stomach. His complexion was worsening as I watched. I don't have much time left. But I guess even having said all this, you probably don't know what to do now. His face was deathly pale. Dark circles were appearing beneath his eyes. The old man sucked in a breath, struggling to exhale. He almost looked like he was on death's door. Was he sick or something?
First, let's see. Yes, Eris.
Hearing that made me frown.
I want you to write her a letter as soon as you can. Tell her you may have cheated on her a little, but you still love her.
No, I don't, I quipped.
She's the reason I had an ED before. Forgive her for that. You're a man, right? You should be able to do that much.
I scowled. He let out a self-mocking laugh. Well, I couldn't forgive her. The two of us didn't get along so great for a couple of years.
What do you mean by that? She nearly killed me countless times. She would follow me wherever I went, and each time she found me, she would go on an all-out attack. Well, still, she did pull her punches. She was perfectly capable of killing if she truly desired it. But she never targeted me when I was at my weakest. In fact, when I was in trouble, she would lend her help for the shadows. Almost like Vegeta from the Dragon Ball series.
Vegeta? Seriously? And that's not me saying that? That's literally Rudius saying that.
Anyway, she's not like the prince of the vegetable kingdom. She just wants to be with you. She's always loved you. Because of those feelings, she's always poured maximum effort into everything she does. However, she's also terrible with words and doesn't know how to express herself. So all she could do is talk with her fists.
That's all well and good, but I already had two wives and a kid. Sure, I may have loved Eris at one point, but that's all in the past now. It's a past I still needed to settle, maybe, but it's over now.
I already have Sylphie and Roxy. No problem. Sylphie is pretty open-minded. As for Roxy, she doesn't even think she's worthy of you. So she'll forgive you for it. Eris will be fine, too, if you explain things beforehand. Besides, if you really do still love her... Besides, you really do still love her, don't you? Oh, but I should warn you. Expect a punch from Eris. That's just the type of woman she is.
I get what you're saying, but...
You get to surround yourself with three women who love you. Sounds wonderful. What's wrong with that? Don't tell me you're not a man enough.
Sorry. Don't tell me you're not man enough.
Don't talk about it so flippantly. It has nothing to do with you.
I have no one left, he said.
I'm telling you this because you are me.
His words carried a strange weight to them, but I still have a responsibility to look after Roxy and Sylphie.
If you want to talk about responsibility, you owe Eris some too. She's been doing her utmost for you this entire time. She's just crap at expressing herself, so you haven't realized it. But she's never stopped trying for your sake. If you think you owe responsibility to other people, then what about her and all the effort she's put in? Ghislaine will hit you with those words as you stand in front of Eris' corpse.
Eris' corpse? So Eris dies too?
Yeah, protecting me, think it was. When I was challenging Atofe again, that Demon King was more fearsome than I expected. I let my guard down.
He spoke as if they were distant memories, his lips curving into a frown.
Just how strong am I in the future if I can afford to let my guard down against someone like Atofe? Is this guy really me? I'm starting to feel even more suspicious.
You have to send that letter, understand? If you don't want the same regrets, do it. It might not be too late for you to start now.
Okay, I guess if you feel that strongly, I can send it, but where to?
The Sword Sanctum. You've probably realized that's where she is by now.
The Sword Sanctum wasn't all that far from Sharia. He was right. I did have a feeling she might be training there.
All right. Don't write anything that might push her away, he warned. If she falls into despair, it'll be the death of you.
I know.
I knew exactly what kind of person Eris was, or at least I used to know. If what she was saying was true, then she never intended to abandon me. Or if what he was saying was true, then she never intended to abandon me. I simply didn't realize that this entire time. Now that I considered what he was saying, she was pretty awful with words. It wasn't surprising that her feelings didn't get through in that letter she left me. And that was the reason the two of us had this misunderstanding and I lost my way. The old man choked out a breath and flinched with a realization and lifted his chin.
Also, I forgot to say one important thing. Don't treat the man god as your enemy.
What? But you just said he's been deceiving me.
Yes, but he is not someone you can defeat. I certainly wasn't able to. I could never reach him.
His voice was thick with anguish. By saying he couldn't reach him, does that mean physically? So that space where the man god resides, it really is somewhere here in this world?
When I realized that, my entire body quaked. I knew I would never be able to get vengeance for Roxy or Sylphie. I poured everything I had into beating him, but I couldn't even get to him. I can manipulate electricity and gravity, but the man god could never come anywhere close enough to me to use my magic against him.
The man pointed to the pot of ink on the table. It lifted into the air for a moment before falling back to my desk and with a clatter, scattering a few stray ink droplets.
I can make things levitate. I can send messages to people from a distance. I can even regrow an arm. More than that, I managed to leap through time and return to the past. He paused. Although this magic was actually a failure.
A failure? What part of this was a failure? He was right here. Right now. Right in front of me, wasn't he?
I am sure you've begun to realize it, but the magic in this world is all powerful. Once you understand that, you can accomplish just about anything, though it will take time, research, and practice to accomplish.
As he spoke, he lifted his left hand. The way he flexed it made it seem like he was bragging, but his face had gone past the point of deathly pale and was now completely white. The circles beneath his eyes were darkening and his lips were turning blue.
But none of this power has any meaning. It was all too late. By the time I got strong enough, the people I wanted to protect were all gone.
There was still a glint in his eyes, but the power had already fled him.
His breathing was erratic and raspy. Do you understand what I've said? I'll tell you one more time. I hate the man god. But I also can't triumph against him. There's no way to beat him. I could not find a way to reach him by myself. The things I required to get to him didn't exist while I was alive. So don't try to fight him.
I have no idea what he's after, but even if you have to act like his toady, do it. Don't oppose him. Don't let him do as he likes. And while all the people you love are still alive.
All the strength fled from his hand and it fell limp. He lifted his chin, his gaze wandering to the ceiling.
There are three things you have to do. Consult Nanahoshi. Write Eris a letter. And doubt the man-god without opposing him. That's all.
I didn't respond to him. It was all so sudden that I didn't have anything to say. One thing was clear. He was desperate to try to tell me that, to tell me something. Can't you give me any more concrete evidence than that? I asked.
Advice, huh? This brings back memories, that's right. I used to be a slacker when I was your age. Well, you know, I would love to give you more details and tell you as much as I can, but my time is up.
You keep saying that, you're out of time, that your time is up. What's with that? Are you in a hurry to catch a midnight anime special or something?
No, I mean it's over. And while we're on the topic, don't rely on others. If you remember when you first came to this world, you didn't rely on anyone.
He gazed at me with that same emotion in his eyes, as if he were looking at his grandchild. Now that he mentions it, I've been leaning on other people a lot recently.
Also, with me coming here, your future should already have changed. The things I say now might not come to pass anymore, but me traveling back to the past like this won't change the history I've lived through.
In the next instant, the focus faded from his eyes. Both his arms hung limply, and he threw his chin up, painfully gasping for air.
You will lead a different life that's different from mine. You'll succeed and fail, just like you always have. You'll reflect on your mistakes and regret them too.
The old man stirred, and the movement caused him to fall out of the chair. Hey, are you okay? I rushed to his side and pulled him into my arms, only to shudder in horror. As muscular and tough as he looked on the inside, or on the outside, he was unbelievably light. He probably didn't even weigh 40 kilograms. What the heck? What's wrong with his body?
Don't, for a second, believe that me coming from the future means you can rectify your mistakes the same way. This magic was a mistake. There's no such thing as being able to redo your life.
His lifeless eyes swam from side to side as he slipped a trembling hand through his robe.
I use this diary as a guide for what date to return to.
Oh, I understand why he thinks that. Yeah, he hasn't met Orsted.
Duh! I'm like, wait a minute, and then I'm like, okay. Here's the thing. Not spoiling, was just confused, and something was clarified. If you read Volume 17, or if you've read Volume 17, you'll know why I had a moment of like, wait, what? And then I was like, oh, he hasn't met Orsted in that timeline. Yeah, never mind. Makes sense.
Okay. And I brought it with me. I've written all my experiences in it. Please do what you can to make sure you don't regret. Don't let that bastard laugh at you like he did to me.
Tears welled up in those hardened eyes as he fished a thick file from his ratty robe. The thing was pretty worn from years of use, but it looked familiar. It was the same folder I'd made for myself just moments before. As I took it from him, the man's hand slipped and struck the floor. That wasn't what caught my attention, however. When he pulled out his diary, I caught a glimpse of the inside of his robe. Where there should have been a stomach, there was nothing. What is that? What's wrong with your body?
My magic was incomplete. I wasn't able to bring my entire body when I traveled back in time.
What? But you just said you could even regrow your arm.
I don't have any mana left. Sorry. If only Cliff were still alive. Maybe this would have gone smoother. Just a little bit longer. I have some more info.
Sorry, you've already done enough. You don't have to say any more.
I don't want you to have regrets or for things to go the way the man god wanted. Why at a time like this, when there's so much I still need to say? But I came all the way back here. If I could at least have a glimpse of...
The man's eyes were no longer looking at me, or anything else, for that matter. What he was saying made no sense. It was just a stream of vague babble now. A black shadow spread beneath his eyes, as if the shadow of death was hanging over him.
So this is what a person looks like before they die.
No, as they're dying.
Ah.
For an instant, his eyes regained focus. They were looking at something over my shoulder. The old man lifted a trembling hand past me.
Ah. Sylphie. Roxy. Damn it. You're both as adorable as ever.
A single tear spilled down his cheek. As the light dispersed from his eyes completely, all the strength left his body and his neck fell limp. He was dead. I glanced over my shoulder, but the door was still shut tight. The man had made quite a ruckus, so I wondered if someone had woken up and rushed down to see what all the fuss was. The old man must have been hallucinating as he took his final breaths. No sooner had I thought that than thundering footsteps came down the stairs. I hurriedly exited the room just in time to see Roxy and Sylphie come to investigate, each with a candle and weapon in hand.
Rudy! I heard voices and some noise. Is someone here? Is it a thief, perhaps?
The two of them looked relieved the moment they saw me, but they still had their guards up.
Should I tell them about the old man?
I hesitated.
No, I shouldn't. No, sorry, I said finally. It was just me being half asleep. I had a weird dream and used some magic. That's what caused all the noise, I think. My bad.
It was just magic you used in your sleep? Sylphie asked in disbelief.
But I thought I heard someone shouting. Are you okay?
If you're having a hard time, should we sleep in the same room? You know, my grandmother did say that when one is in pain, feeling the warmth of another human is the best remedy.
No, I'm good. Pretty sure I'd try something dirty if I slept with you, and you're not quite back to full health yet, are you?
As I refused Sylphie's tempting offer, Roxy pulled a face.
If it's really that bad, you can sleep with me. Although I have begun to suspect I might be...
At any rate, if you could just keep it to just touching me... Nah, I'm really okay today. Although Roxy hadn't finished what she was saying, her words triggered memories of what the old man mentioned. He said she was pregnant. Judging by the way she spoke, she thought as much too.
It's really, truly all right, I assured them.
You two go back to bed. I'll get to sleep after I tidy up my office. Sylphie nodded slowly.
Well, if you're sure, okay, but if you need one of us, feel free to say okay.
We are husband and wife, after all, so please don't hesitate. Anyway, good night. The two of them still looked deeply concerned as they headed back up to the second floor. I watched them leave before turning back to my study. First, I needed to confirm the veracity of what the old man told me. I still had no idea of who he really was, whether he was actually me from the future or someone else entirely. Considering he risked his own life to get here and warn me, what he said seemed believable. The bigger problem was it was so sudden that it was hard to digest. There was one thought that wouldn't leave my head, though. I don't want to lose those two. And I didn't want to die with regrets like that old man did, either. I followed the two girls to their rooms to make sure they were safe, and I expressly forbade them from coming out again tonight. I went to every room on the second floor and locked them from the outside to keep everyone from leaving. After that, I descended the stairs, swept the first floor to make sure no one was around. Once I was sure the coast was clear, I went back to my study to strip the old man.
What?
He didn't have a stomach. Beneath his rib cage was an open hole where all you could see was the bone and skin. He had almost no intestines. That spot aside, the rest of his body was pretty incredible. It was hard to believe there were muscles of someone in their late 60s.
He was covered in battle scars. There was a particularly unique one on his chest, as if his skin had been welded back together there. Even his freckles were in the same place as his mind. As far as I could see, he was exactly like me. The only thing that set us apart was that he had a fully functioning left hand. He did mention he'd regrown it himself. He must have been pretty skilled at healing magic to manage that. Other than the diary, he wasn't really carrying anything else. He didn't have any accessories or even a staff. All he wore under his robe was a shirt, underwear, and pants. There was nothing in any of his pockets, either. Pretty sure if Sylphie and Roxy died, I'd be carrying around some kind of keepsake. On the other hand, if 50 years had passed, perhaps he'd been through a lot and lost those memories. Oh, no, mementos, sorry. After setting his articles aside, I wrapped the old man's body in the blanket that had been lying nearby. I carried him out through the kitchen, heading for the back door. I paused as I spotted some leftovers from last night on the counter. They were left piled on a plate. These were the ones that claimed the rats. He claimed that rats would nibble at, and it was probably best to get rid of them. I slipped through our rear garden and carried the old man's body to a nearby vacant lot, where I dug a grave, set him inside, and set fire to it. My magic was powerful enough to turn him into ash and bones within seconds. The stench of burned flesh hung thick in the air. It was all the more nauseating knowing it was coming from my charred corpse. Ugh. The thought made my stomach lurch. I raced to the edge of the lot and vomited. Once I'd finished cremating him, I used my magic to conjure a pot and put his bones inside. I would bury him in the same spot where I put Paul. If he really was my future self, that was the spot where he'd be happiest. I refilled the hole after I finished collecting his bones. Next, I returned to the house, slipping through the back door before heading straight to my study. I left the old man's remains beside his clothes and grabbed my staff. My destination this time was the basement. I'd already activated my demon eye. The old man had told me not to go. He warned that the rat would go out, nibble at our leftovers, and that the disease it carried would then be transferred to Roxy. But I had to be sure. I had to know if the rat was really there or not. If I didn't see for myself, I wouldn't be able to believe what he said. Plus, if he was right, I couldn't leave the rodent unchecked. The stairs leading to the basement were dark. I pulled out a lamplight spirit scroll to illuminate the area. After descending, I took a deep breath and placed my hand on the door. Dust had collected in a corner of the stairwell. I spotted what I was looking for. Tracks. Rat footprints, to be precise. I could also see where its tail had dragged behind it. These footprints only went one way, into the basement. There were no tracks to show it had left. I couldn't bring myself to open the door. Instead, I used magic to make a hole in the door, about the size of my fist. Then I poured mana into my staff and pushed it through the opening. I pictured ice in my mind, enough to fill the entire room. Inside were magic items and Aisha's fertilizer that she used to garden. But all those things were inconsequential. Frost Nova, I whispered in an instant. In an instant, ice rippled through the room. Just to be on the safe side, I repeated the spell. Frost Nova. A chill spread from my staff, enveloping every nook and cranny of the basement. I sent my lamplight spirit through the hole and looked in to make sure the entire room was iced over. Finally, I opened the frozen door, stepped inside, and immediately closed it behind me. I found the rat instantly. It was dead, frozen solid as it stood near the hidden door that led to my personal shrine. The creature's mouth was half open, purple teeth peeking out. They really did look like magic stones. I did a thorough sweep of the area to make sure a second one hadn't sneaked in. Once I was certain it was safe, I created a box with earth magic. Used two sticks to safely pick up the rat's corpse and placed it inside. Then I sealed it so no one could inadvertently open it. Would it be best to burn this thing and be rid of it? Or maybe I should send it to the Magician's Guild for study. The latter seemed the best option. If I reported what I'd heard from the old man about petrification syndrome when I handed the rat's body over to the guild, they could check the veracity of his claims, although I had no idea whether they could extract the pathogen from a frozen corpse. I locked the basement door behind me and sealed the hole I'd made. The old man said the disease didn't have airborne transmission and wasn't very contagious, but it was better safe than sorry.
I returned to my study. I was fully awake after all of that, so I wouldn't be getting shut-eye at any time soon. So what should I do first? Or rather, what is it that I can do right now? Should I read this weather diary the old man had brought with him? Maybe it could warn me about future events. Although he also said that history had already changed. In sci-fi terms, I was already in an alternate timeline, one created by my future self traveling back in time. Even if I read everything contained within this journal and prepared for it, it was likely that many of the things he'd faced wouldn't come to pass. My eyes fixed upon my ink bottle and the black stain it had left on my desk. Burn marks also remained from where the old man had concentrated mana into his fist and slammed them down. Seeing it triggered the memory of what he told me. There are three things you have to do. There was one thing in his list I could do right now. I sat down, took out a piece of paper, and grabbed my pen. First, I wrote Eris a letter. She was my first partner in bed and someone I had once loved before she disappeared out of nowhere. I still had complex feelings about her. What should I even write? I wondered as I set my pen to the paper.
And there you go, guys. That is chapter 11. Now we have the extra chapter, The Birth of a New Sword King. So 96%. I am curious, Oldius. Oh my God. Yeah, Oldius never met Orsted. He mentioned not meeting Orsted in Laplace. I don't think he would have met Laplace originally because isn't Laplace not scheduled for reincarnation until, like, he's not scheduled to come back for a while or something? Is it reincarnation? I don't even know. if he'd kept records of everything he studied. Yeah, right? Strange he didn't remember that his other eye can see the future. Yeah, also true. Oldius. Well, it looks like Rudy is finally going to man up again. Yeah, damn right. All right, so, I'm curious to hear what everyone else thinks about this moment. We've got Saiyan and Spider that are commenting on this. What did you guys think? If this is your first time reading this, what did you think now? What do you think now? And when you first read this, what were your thoughts? I'm curious. Let me see that in the chat. I want to see that in the chat, please. All right. Pain, but good stuff. All right, so here we go. Three sword saints were gathered in the Sword Sanctum's ephemeral hall, each one of them on one knee. There was Nina Fallion, Gino Britz, and Eris Greyrat. Standing before them was the sword god Galfallion. Okay, I just realized we only have 13 pages in total in this book, so that means this is going to be probably about 10 pages or so, which isn't much. He stood with at ease as he glared down at his pupils, who all had their hands over the swords at their hips. Slowly, he said, "Your sword play has already surpassed the level of sword saint." Gino's shoulders twitched. "It's almost time to recognize the first sword king since Ghislaine." Gino's eyes went wide. He clenched his fist, trembling. An indescribable emotion swept over him. He wanted to jump up and shout, but he tamped down on the urge. He had yet to identify what this sensation was. It wasn't a bad one, that much he knew. The sword god, however, wasn't finished. "Before we do that, I have a question." Everyone waited silently. "What do you three think separates a sword saint, a sword king, and a sword emperor?" "Strength?" Nina blurted. It was clear from their collective expressions that they couldn't fathom any other answer. Yet at the same time, they also knew it wasn't that simple. The sword god wanted to know what came after that strength.
What else separated them? "Nina, what did your teacher tell you to do before acquiring the Sword of Light?"
Nina's teacher wasn't Galfallion. The person who had mentioned her was Gino's father,
Timothy Britz. She reflected on the man's teachings and replied, "He said, since you're right-handed, train your left hand. He told me I wouldn't be able to release the Sword of Light until I could perfectly wield a sword in my left hand." "That's right. Your non-dominant hand is important for using the Sword of Light."
Do you understand why? If you tense your dominant hand, it will cause the blade to shift to the side.
Yes.
You need to invest all of your battle aura into the attack and cut in a straight line. It's simple, but that is the innermost secret of the Sword of Light technique. Swordsmanship was all about cutting down a moving target. If you charged straight in and used a frontal attack, anyone could dodge it easily. That was why sword wielders attacked from below, the side, or diagonally, using unpredictable moves to catch their enemy off guard.
Oh, there it is. I knocked over my mouse. Give me a second. There we go.
Well then, Spider, tell me what you thought upon meeting Oldius and what all he had to say. I'm curious to hear your thoughts. I want to hear everybody's thoughts about this whole conversation and this big reveal that came from Turning Point 4.
All right, anyway.
Okay. However, the first sword god was different. He didn't need those tricks. Instead, he cut down everything by moving faster than his opponent could react. This secret is embedded in the sword god style's history. Gall struck his nails against the hilt of his sword. Each generation of sword god has worked to slowly unravel the inexplicable techniques the first sword god cultivated. That is what led us to the current form of the sword god style. Once you understand the innermost secrets of the Sword of Light, the principle behind it, and how to practice using it, it's very simple. Anyone with a little talent can easily learn to wield it. That led to the age of the Sword God style being considered the strongest. We can hold our heads up proudly thanks to the first Sword God and his predecessors who unlocked the secrets of his techniques. Again, his fingers drummed against the hilt of his sword. The Sword of Light is the Sword God style's best technique. Practitioners of other styles would call it our secret technique. However, there are some who grasp the essence of it better than others. Sword Saints, Sword Kings, Sword Emperors, and the Sword God. Kinda strange, really. We're all doing the same thing, but some of us are stronger than some of us are weaker. Gall turned his gaze to Gino. What do you think makes the difference, Gino? Answer me. Gino lifted his chin, face pulled into a nervous expression. He had no idea what the answer was, but he felt pressured to answer quickly. The ability to think logically, to move skillfully, body strength, or maybe weapon quality? Weapon quality. How many years have you been training for, boy? You sure you don't need to go back to start from the basics? Oh. Weapon quality? How many years have you been training for, boy? You sure you don't need to go back to and start from the basics? Gall barked at him. My apologies. Gino's face went pale as he dropped his gaze. What Gino really wanted to say was talent, but he knew well it wasn't. That wasn't the response the sword god desired. There was no way a question that complex could be answered in a single word. After all, they were discussing the intricacies of talent right now. If Gino said something that stupid, Gall might drive him out entirely. You don't know because you're still just a kid, huh? Doesn't matter. The strong are still strong, whether they understand it or not. All right, Nina, you answer. Nina considered her question carefully, or considered her answer carefully. Most likely, he was asking what separated them from those who outranked them. It had to be something sword kings and the like had that Nina and her fellow sword saints did not. Come to think of it, the people in those positions, sword gods, sword emperor, etc., all had life partners. She wanted that too. A boyfriend or a husband. Nina glanced over at Gina. He still had his gaze glued to the floor and a vexed look on his face. He was younger than her, but lately she'd taken quite an interest in him. Suddenly, a word occurred to her that she often heard the sword god use. Is it desire? Huh. Well, you sure have been maturing a lot more lately, acting more feminine. Just what I'd expect from a daughter of mine. He laughed, seeing straight through her. Nina didn't react. She had practiced to make sure that these kinds of things wouldn't get under her skin. Desire. Well, you're not wrong there, but how long can your own desire endure? What do you mean by that? For instance, if I told you that you would have to pick between marrying Gino and becoming a Sword King, which would you pick? At the mention of marriage, Gino and Nina traded glances. Her cheeks flushed slightly. I would pick becoming a Sword King. In other words, she would abandon the chance to marry Gino. That showed the limits of her own desires. She realized belatedly that her answer had been a mistake. Naive as ever, he snorted with laughter as she dropped her gaze. Gaul then turned his attention to the last member of their group. What about you, Eris? Determination. Determination, huh? Nope, that's wrong too, he chuckled and dismissed her. Eris, however, merely glared back at him and said, No, it's not. Determination is the right answer. In the back of her mind, she saw Orsted stabbing Rudeus through the chest. She remembered lamenting how powerless she was as he crumpled to the ground. She had become stronger since then. Her power and speed were on a completely different level. However, it wasn't enough to beat Orsted. After years of training, Eris had glimpsed the limits of her abilities. No matter how much she trained, she would never reach Orsted's level. It wasn't an exaggeration. She knew she would never be able to defeat him on her own. But it would be a different story if she was with Rudeus. Together, they would be able to accomplish it. With his magic and her sword skills, they could win. Even if I had to sacrifice myself to pin Orsted down, Rudeus would land the final blow. If Rudeus won, that would also be a win for Eris. She would die, of course, but Rudeus would live on. It meant she would lose out on sharing a future with him, but she didn't mind that. Dwelling on the future would only make her lose her nerve, and losing her nerve would make her sword dull. A dull sword meant they would both die. If anyone was going to lose their life, it would be her. Eris was determined to pursue that outcome. Or perhaps, one might say, she was resigned to it. Then you don't care if you can't become a Sword King? Gaul asked. That doesn't really matter to me. I thought you wanted to get stronger. Yes, I do. But a title doesn't change how strong a person is, does it? Please, the Sword God muttered. All right, Eris and Nina. Whichever one of you can beat the other will be named Sword King. Gino's shoulders slumped in defeat. Nina and Eris faced one another. Each of them wielded a wooden sword, although it didn't seem like a lethal weapon. In the hands of two sword saints, it could easily be used to end another's life. This brings back memories of the first time I came here. Indeed. It had been several years since Ghislaine first brought Eris to the sword sanctum. Eris had been like a wild animal, and because of her, Nina had tasted humiliation. After all, she had wet herself in front of Gino and the other sword saints. Just remembering the incident was enough to make Nina want to cover her face and writhe in agony. That said, she held no hatred for Eris. Thanks to Eris, she had become stronger. She discarded her pride and immersed herself completely in her training. Her humiliation was what motivated her. Nina confidently asserted, "Today I will be the victor." Bloodlust spilled off Eris in waves, but Nina didn't flinch. She was like an enlightened monk in training. The way she stared at Eris with a cool, composed expression. In the next instant, all hostility from Eris vanished. Her expression was the polar opposite of Nina's. She was smiling maniacally, like a predator staring down its prey. The way her disturbing grin stretched from ear to ear was enough to make anyone shiver. Sorry, checking a thing. Okay. An instinctive fear sparked inside Nina. Many times had they traded blows under Water King Isolde's training, and Nina had lost. Of course, there were times when she won, too, but memories of defeat stood out sharpest in her mind, particularly because each time Nina lost, Eris had that grin on her face. Eris wasn't moving. She remained deathly still. That bestial smile on her face, This was rare for her, considering she was always the first to make a move. She was waiting to counter her attacks, Nina thought. She had faced counters numerous times when she fought Isolde. Eris couldn't use Water God-style techniques, but the North God-style also possessed counters. That was most likely what Eris was aiming for. Silence hung in the air. Eris held her weapon at her shoulder at shoulder level, while Nina held hers above her head. They both stood perfectly still, only one step away from the other. Nina's face was expressionless, while Eris wore a big grin on hers. The two resembled a couple of eerie statues the way they stared at one another without so much as flinching. The stillness was unusual for two students of the Sword God style, which preached that the first to make a move would be the victor. Neither one of them dared move. It was Galfalian who finally breathed a sigh. "How long are the two of you going to stand there and stare at each other?" Those words were the trigger. Nina was the first to move. She took a confident step forward, footwork she had done some 10,000 times over the course of her training. The way she moved her legs was logical, optimal. And energy surged through her torso. Nina blended this energy with her battle aura, sending it down her arm and into her blade. Sword of Light, this skill touted as the fastest of all, rushed toward Eris. Nina's technique was impeccable. Anyone who saw it would be amazed, struck speechless by its perfection, but... Gah! A heavy force slammed into Nina's stomach, rocketing her backward. Her body crashed into the wall before crumpling to the ground. Her uniform was shredded, leaving her toned stomach visible. A large red welt slowly spread across her skin. A burning sensation shot through her body. "Enough!" declared the sword god. Nina stared blankly at Eris. Sweat dripped off the latter's forehead. Her uniform was slightly split on the shoulder, but she was otherwise unscathed. That smile had also disappeared from her face. She stood there proudly as the victor. Nina understood what had happened. Eris stepped forward at the same time that Nina made her move, and while Nina swung down from above, Eris dropped her body low and released her own Sword of Light from the side. What Nina didn't understand was why. Her own technique should have landed first. She made the opening move, and her sword was ever so slightly faster than Eris's. Moreover, she had swung from above, which was the fastest attack position. Even according to some slight miscalculations, her attack should have landed before Eris, or even accounting for her, sorry. But their battle didn't even end in a draw. Why was she slumped against the wall while Eris remained standing? "You don't need overwhelming power to beat a person," Eris said quietly. Nina didn't understand. Eris had used a North God-style technique. Ordinarily, Sword of Light was overkill on most opponents. Eris had diverted its power into speed instead. She made it so her attack was only just lethal enough to knock down her opponent, which made her execution that much faster. It wasn't just brute strength, but the distribution of her battle aura. This was a technique she learned from her training with the North Emperor. The added speed it gave her was honestly negligible compared to how much attack power she sacrificed to achieve it. Yet this difference, little more than a hair's breadth, was what it took to claim victory. "Magnificent! Eris, I give you the title of Sword King!" Nina slowly peeled herself off the floor, her face contorted as her stomach throbbed with dull pain. She completely outdid me. Because they were using wooden swords, she had merely been thrown back and bruised. If Eris had a real sword, it might have plunged right through Nina's heart. A comparatively weak attack considering the normal power of a Sword of Light could cleave a person's body in two, but it was still enough to kill. As Eris had only sustained a tear in the shoulder of her uniform, that was more than enough to qualify her as the victor. Nina had lost completely. Nina sighed and sat on the floor, stretching her back out. She'd lost this duel in every way. The opening move was hers, and she was still defeated. I lost completely and utterly. It's over. A heavy, oppressive weight settled on her chest. "Feeling vexed, Nina?" asked the sword god. "Yes." Large tears rolled down her cheeks. "You still have room to grow. Buck up." "Yes, father." That day, for the first time in a long time, she called Gaul her father rather than her master. The sword god waited quietly for her tears to dry. Eris returned to frowning, crossing her arms over her chest as she stood nearby. Once Nina finished sniffling, Gaul turned to Eris and said, "I will give you the title of Sword King, but I have nothing more to teach you. You are a master." A master, as the name implied, was someone who had achieved complete mastery in the style. Nina and Gino traded looks. The two sword emperors and even Sword King Ghislaine had never received the title of master. That was how exclusive such recognition was. "I can also give you the title of Sword Emperor while I'm at it, but in that case you will have to battle Ghislaine. If you want to go further and call yourself Sword God, you will need to kill me." He placed a hand on the hilt of his sword as if challenging her to answer. Eris shook her head. "The title of Sword God doesn't matter to me. Figured you'd say that. Well then, what are you going to do now? First, I'll return to my family." As the sword god gazed into her eyes, he was struck by how bright they were. Eris had always carried a sense of loss with her. If she continued her quest to become stronger and didn't lose sight of her original objective, perhaps she could actually bring down the invincible Orsted. Such was the potential that Gaul sensed in her. "Come, Eris, as proof that you are a sword king, I shall give you one of my 7 blades." "Okay." Literally, that's how I imagine her doing it. It's just, okay. That day, Eris Greyrat's long years of training came to an end. As Eris and the Sword God left, the ceremony to determine the new Sword King officially ended. Only Nina and Gino remained in the room. For a while, they sat in silence. Both were overcome with frustration and envy, but neither one would let it show on their faces, nor would they speak of it. Silently, they both stood up and walked shoulder to shoulder over to the edge of the ephemeral hall, where the wooden swords were kept. Each of them reached for a weapon. Shortly thereafter, the clang of their blades could be heard echoing through the room. It was a common symphony that rang throughout the sword sanctum daily, and as the two trained, so did that rhythmic tune continue.
That is book frickin' 14.
Forgive the bad taste here, or the joke, but it's in the books. All right. Volume 14 is now in the books. We get to start volume 15 next, and oh my god, I can't wait. Who wants a little preview? Fucking everybody better. All right. So first things first with volume 15. Waiting on it to... Okay, so I had to download it from... Okay, cool. Oh boy. Go to cover. There we go. All right. So here's what we're looking at. This is what we've got coming up. We have Orsted, Rudeus, Eris, and some sort of contraption right there. But yes, now 15 volumes. Remember, she left in volume 6. Her and Rudy are finally going to meet up 9 volumes later. It's ridiculous. I will read your paragraphs happily, Spider. Don't you worry. All right, so on to the next. We've got that. This is going to be the cover of the next one. We get Rudeus, Sylphie, Cliff, Zenova, Orsted, Eris, and Ghislaine all on the next image. And then probably one of the coolest images right there. No major spoilers. You just get that. But here we go. I cannot wait to read the next 2 chapters. The Diary Part 1 and Part 2. And that is kind of how it's going to go, guys. That's how the next chapter will go. I'm seriously looking forward to that. So, my phone's buzzing again. Also, we got through this one pretty quick. I was super surprised with how quickly we got through it. Ready. So, I am now going to read some of your comments. Bro, just read it now and 5 years later. All right. So here we go. It's kind of annoying to me that he didn't tell his wives. Yeah, I can understand that. It wasn't an oh shit moment for you. Why wasn't it?
It wasn't a purple-hooked rat you knocked over. Okay, good thing, yeah. All right, so, really a spoiler since it's part of the author Q&A, but the North God style is the only style where the newer gods of the style are stronger than their predecessors. Oh. It was unexpected the way he didn't outright explain the spell left him dying, despite how he was aware of how dumb his past self was gonna be when he showed up. Okay. A lot of things fall into place with this time travel incident, clearly, but I feel like it's gonna be a bit before Rudeus finally realizes just how ridiculous his power is. Right? I'm glad he was really smart in how he handled the rat, too. Rudeus still, as of the latest English light novel, doesn't get where his power lays. Yeah, that's also kind of true. Though it's sad that he didn't confide in his wives from the anime and manga, he probably has a vague idea of how annoying time travel business gets the more unnecessary stuff you do. Okay. No, those paragraphs were fine. There's... Oh, it was an oh shit moment. Okay, I was like, wait a minute. What do you mean it wasn't an oh shit moment? That was... It's the very definition of an oh shit moment. Okay. For the people that hung around, I'm going to do a thing. Really quickly, guys, I want to say thank you to everybody on YouTube for coming and checking out these videos. I am about to do a thing that is going to actually get cut from the YouTube videos. I will not be showing this. So, that having been said, I'm going to go ahead and end this part of the stream right here for both Twitch and for YouTube. I'm going to end the stream. And I'm going to start a second stream in a minute or so where I'm going to show the thing for the people that are still hanging out here so they get an extra treat. And I'm going to do my exercises. So don't post the exercises, Rage, until I'm more scared of her than I would be of Sylvie and Roxy. Yeah, there you go. That explains a lot. But straight up, guys, don't go anywhere. Hold on to the tally of all the exercises until we get back. I want to make sure that everything is good to go. And of course, guys, please let me know in the comments on the Light Novel channel, Fat Dog Light Novels, where you think things are going, what you thought of these chapters, what you've thought of the story overall as we get through this. I'm curious to see what you all think. So let me know down in the comments. That having been said, yeah, I'll see you guys in a bit. For Twitch viewers and for all of you on YouTube, thank you for coming by, commenting. Make sure to like and subscribe to the channel if you have not done so already. That having been said, yeah, I appreciate the views, but thumbs up to the channel, really thumbs up on videos really, really does help with the channel, and that's even more important on the actual main Fat Dog content. So if you have not liked our content for our bridge stuff, please go check that out and please go watch it. That having been said, thank you guys so much, and I'll see you soon. Bye-bye for now.